हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू माई क्लास. टुडे टुडे विल सी द नेक्स्ट मेडिकल सर्जिकल नर्सिंग टॉपिक, दैट इज पल्मरी एम्बोलिज्म. सो पल्मरी इज समथिंग पर्टेनिंग टू द लंग्स एंड एम्बोलिज्म इज अ मूविंग क्लॉट. सो इवन एनी मूविंग क्लॉट, दैट इज एम्बोलिज्म, इज कमिंग एंड अब्स्ट्रक्टिंग द पल्मरी वेसल्स एंड देयर बाय देर इज नो ब्लड फ्लो टू द लंग्स, देन वी कॉल इट एज पल्मरी एम्बोलिज्म. ओके, सो इट इज अ मूविंग ब्लड क्लॉट विच इज कॉल्ड एम्बोले फ्रॉम अ वीनस सिस्टम. सो इन एनी ऑफ द वेन्स ऑफ द बॉडी, it because all the veins enters the superior vena cava or the inferior vena cava and drain into the right atrium and they go to the pulmonary artery. So when there is any block for any clot, this clot will move and enter the pulmonaries and thereby they will result in obstruction of blood flow to the alveoli and lungs, that is called as pulmonary embolism. So you can see, so this is the pulmonary capillaries. Okay, so there are, so lungs are divided into so many alveoli. Same way the heart will bring the deoxygenated blood, and this deoxygenated blood, this blue color is the deoxygenated blood which enter into both the lungs. Okay, so this, after the pulmonary artery comes, it divides and gives so many branches, and these branches will go to the alveoli. And you can see here some in pulmonary capillaries there is a block or obstruction. This is called obstructions. Okay, so here you can see the area. So the pulmonary capillaries are obstructed. So when there is obstruction in the pulmonary capillaries, blood will stop here. After this area, blood cannot move. Okay, so this, after this part of the lungs will not get blood supply, so that oxygenation cannot take place, and because of that the lungs also will not get the blood and oxygen. That is called as pulmonary embolism. Okay, next coming to the causes of pulmonary embolism. So pulmonary embolism is mainly caused due to three causes. One is venous stasis. Okay, so whenever there is stasis, means whenever the venous is accumulated in a part. Okay, so venous blood vein is there. So when the blood in the veins are standing for a long time, then the clot material will join together and form clot, that is called as venous stasis. Okay, and next is endothelial injury. Okay, so endothelium means it is the inner lining of the blood vessels. Okay, so blood vessel is there, inner lining, it has got in some injury, and because of that, whenever there is an injury, the platelets will come in that area to form the clot and close the injury. Okay, so that time the clot can form in the blood vessels. Okay, so that is endothelial injury. And next is hypercoagulability stage. Okay, so hypercoagulability state. So in hypercoagulability state means there is some condition in our body where the blood is going into hyper, means more formation of clot. So when more formation of clot is there, this material will cause emboli or thrombus, and this thrombus later it can become a emboli and obstruct the pulmonary arteries. Okay, in venous stasis the condition are deep vein thrombosis. So in deep vein thrombosis means deep vein there is clot formation. Okay, so this can occur because of prolonged standing or prolonged lying down in the same position. So at these areas the venous blood is staying in a particular area and the clot material will join together and form a clot. And next, obesity and pregnancy. Okay, so in these stage, in these conditions also there will be the fetal and the body pressure will move towards the leg. So the whole body weight is will move towards the leg, and because of that in the leg the deep veins the muscles will compress the blood vessels, and when the blood vessels are compressed then they form clot within inside. And then same way if there is any tumor near the veins. Okay, so when the tumors compress the vein, again in that area blood will stay and thereby they can go for clot formation. And dehydration, in dehydration there is more loss of body fluids. When the body fluids are lost, the blood cells, the consistency of the blood cells, concentration of the blood cells will increase because of the lack of fluid. Okay, that means they won't be dilute, they will be concentrated. When they are concentrated, the clot materials will join together and form clot. And immobility. Okay, same. So immobility is one main cause for deep vein thrombosis. When a person is lying in a place for a long time on the dependent areas of the body, the blood will get accumulated and they form clot. And next is polycythemia. Polycythemia means it is increased RBC in the blood. Okay, so increased RBCs occur in the blood when there is more increased RBC, the concentration of the blood will also increase, and these patients are more common, more easily prone for getting clot formation. And next is congestive heart failure. So congestive heart failure is a condition where the heart is not able to function. Okay, congestion means there are so many blood in the heart and the heart is failing. That means heart is not able to contract or pump and send the blood outside. When the heart is not sending the blood outside, all the blood will start backflowing and they go and get congested in the veins. When the in the veins, if they are congested, then they are easily prone for clot formation. Okay, so these are all causes in venous stasis. And next is endothelial injury. So endothelial injury can occur because of any surgery or trauma. Okay, so trauma is any injury. So any time patient blood vessels can be cut, and once they are going for repair, the surgical site will form clot. And next is fracture. Again, fracture is a broken bone. This can accidentally injure the blood vessels, and the injured area can go for clot formation, because whenever there is an injury or bleeding, our platelets will come in that area and act in order to produce the clot. And alcoholism, drugs, oral contraceptives, so these are all chemicals which can irritate the walls of the blood vessels, and thereby they can go for endothelial injury. Again, cigarette smoking, this also contains nicotine, which is a tar like material which will go and accumulate or spread on the inner lining of the blood vessels. So these nicotine are more attracted to platelets and they will attract and form a clot. And next cause is the hypercoagulability state. So hypercoagulability means there is increased coagulation in the blood vessels. So this can be due to any inherited or any genetic disorder. That means by birth itself the cells are not formed properly. So that is any deficiency of antithrombin. Thrombin proteinase protein C. Okay, so these are all necessary blood thinners. Okay, so they are mainly important for thinning or diluting the blood. Okay, so when they are deficient, then person can go for hypercoagulation. Okay, because they cannot dilute the blood. And then fibrinogen abnormality. Okay, so when the fibrinogen also fibrinogen has to produce in a normal amount. Okay, if it is activated more, then more fibrin material will get accumulate and they form the coagulation. Okay, and then medical illness. Okay, so any medical conditions like AIDS, systemic lupus erythematosus, so these are the disease where the person's blood is more prone for going to clot. Okay, so when there is more clot, then they can go and accumulate in any of the veins. When the veins are accumulated with the blood clot, in the force of blood, these clot will move and come into the pulmonary area and they will obstruct the pulmonary capillaries. Okay, so this is about causes. Next, coming to the pathophysiology. Okay, pathophysiology of pulmonary embolism. Okay, so any predisposing factors that causes formation of clot in the deep veins. Okay, so I said all the Virchow's triad. Okay, those three triad is called as Virchow's triad. Okay, so because of these Virchow's triad, there is formation of clot in the deep veins. So spontaneous dislodgement of the clot by the jarring force of the blood. Okay, that means when the blood is going in the veins, by the force they can dislocate or dislodge. Okay, they can scrape or scratch the walls of the blood vessel so that the clot will start moving. Okay, or removing from that area. So spontaneous dislodgement means they will move by jarring force of the blood. Okay, that is the force of the blood. And clot detach from the walls of the blood vessels and moves into the veins. Okay, so that means in which vein the clot is formed, in that area the clot will come out of the sides of the blood vessels and they will move inside the veins. Okay, and the moving clot is called as emboli. Okay, and the moving clot and via the venous system they enters the pulmonary artery. So you know, whole part of the body, the venous blood will come and drain into the inferior vena cava and superior vena cava. So when the when in force when the blood is moving, the venous system will carry also the clot with themselves and they will enter the pulmonary arteries. So in the pulmonary artery the clot may be a small size, okay, but when it is giving branches to both the lungs and from the lungs they are giving so many capillaries, this clot can go and dislodge or obstruct in any of the small capillaries, okay, so then moves into the capillaries and causing obstruction of blood in the pulmonary capillaries, okay, so they cause obstruction of blood, and once the pulmonary capillary the blood is obstructed, there is lack of perfusion to the of blood to alveoli. So when you see one alveoli will be there and in one, for one alveoli one capillary will move like this, okay, so from the pulmonary capillaries, pulmonary artery, the pulmonary capillaries will divide and they give the blood supply, and when they come here oxygenation takes place. Oxygenation means increased carbon dioxide in the blood will move into the alveoli, and increased oxygen in the alveoli will move into the pulmonary capillaries, and then they will go and drain into pulmonary vein where they will bring to the heart for circulation, okay, so this is what happens in oxygenation, okay. Now here because of the obstruction, blood is getting obstructed here, they cannot go to the alveoli, so now alveoli are not getting the blood, okay, so that is called lack of perfusion of blood in the alveoli, and when the alveoli blood is not going, they cannot do the function of oxygenation, okay, oxygen cannot transfer to the capillaries, so decrease oxygenation of the blood and impaired perfusion of the tissues, okay, so if the pulmonary capillaries alveoli is not giving blood to pulmonary capillaries, then the blood will oxygenated blood cannot go to the heart. When the blood is not going to the heart, the tissues also will not receive the blood and the tissues start failing or losing their function. This is what happens in pulmonary embolism. Okay, next coming to the clinical manifestation or signs and symptoms. Okay, clinical manifestation. Okay, so first patient will have tachypnea, that is increased breathing because lack of oxygen, so patient will take increased breathing, okay, and dyspnea which is shortness of breath or difficulty in breathing, and tachycardia is increased heart rate, so whenever the lungs do not get oxygen or blood, our heart will start to pump faster so that they can increase the blood supply, so at that time patient will go for tachycardia, and pulse will be rapid and weak, okay, because heart is functioning more and more fastly, then the pulse also will be rapid, that means very fast and weak, and pleuritic chest pain because the clot is obstructing the blood vessels and the blood vessels are also getting bulging before the clot and they can compress any of the nerves and thereby patient will go for pain, and there will be sputum and this sputum will also come like hemoptysis, okay, hemoptysis, this is because when there is obstruction here, sorry, when there is obstruction previous area, so much blood will be loaded, and when the blood is loaded this area will go into bulging and they start the fluid and blood will start leaving the capillaries and coming outside, so at that time in the lungs blood will get accumulated and this blood can be coughed up in the sputum, okay, and when you auscultate the chest you can hear rails or crackles, these are abnormal breath sounds you can hear, this is due to fluid and air or beating with each other, okay, and patient can go for fever, cough, this is because fever and cough because any obstruction the blood will accumulate inside and it can cause WBC and except neutrophils and other production which can cause an inflammation and thereby patient can go for fever. Okay, next patient will have altered mental status. This is because when the blood is not going to the brain. Okay, so which all area of the body or tissues is not getting the blood supply, that area will get affected. Okay, so altered mental status when the brain is not receiving proper blood supply. And pallor, again when there is no blood supply to the tissues, patient will become body will become white, that is called as pallor, okay, other than this according to the area of blood supply there will be problem in the renal function of the patient if the blood is not going to the kidneys, okay, that is changes in urination, okay, again if the problem in GI function, So here patient can go for indigestion. Okay, indigestion and vomiting, etc. If the person is not getting the blood supply to the GI. Diagnostic findings of pulmonary embolism. First, we can do an ABG analysis. In ABG analysis, there will be decreased saturation and decreased partial pressure of oxygen. Okay, so this is because embolism is not allowing the blood supply, and this is also related to heart. So you should take an ECG. In ECG, you can see atrial fibrillation. This is because there is no blood supply to the heart and heart is trying to beat faster. And echocardiography, so in this you can see that if there is any blood changes or pressure changes in the heart. Next, you can see a chest x-ray. In chest x-ray, you can see cardiomegaly. Okay, that is increased size of the heart because the blood is not oxygenating in the lungs. There is obstruction. All the blood will start backflow into the heart. Okay, and then you can do a CT scan. So in CT scan, there is so many things like multi-detector. Okay, CT angiography. Okay, so angiography means it will show the blood vessels. So in this, you can see any pulmonary obstruction or embolism can be identified. Okay, and again, you can do a ventilation perfusion scan. Okay, this is called VQ scan. This is mainly to identify the oxygenation, that is gas exchange, if it is present between the alveoli and the capillaries. Okay, so in the alveoli and capillaries, the gas exchange can be identified. Okay, next we have venous ultrasound. You can do so. In that, you can see in the lower extremities if there is any formation of thrombosis. Okay, thrombosis can be identified in the deep veins. Okay, and in blood you have to do a D-dimer. D-dimer is mainly for any coagulation. So D-dimer will be increased due to coagulation. Okay, and again antithrombin factor assays to be done. These are all coagulation studies to identify if the person is prone for getting coagulated. Okay, so coagulation studies. And next you should also do a platelet count. So in case so much of platelets is gone for clotting, then the platelet count will be decreased in the circulating blood. Okay, and prothrombin time, partial thromboplastin time. Okay, so these are all elevated when the person is having a increased clot formation. Okay, so other than this, the main study which can confirm the diagnosis is pulmonary angiography. So angiography, so in this they keep the patient in a fluoroscopic screen and they inject a needle, inject a catheter inside the femoral vein, and through the femoral vein they go into the pulmonary vessels, and in the pulmonary vessels they will inject a dye. When the dye is injected, which part of the pulmonary capillaries is obstructing, that is the dye is not flowing properly, you can see. So with that you can identify or confirm the presence of obstruction in the capillaries. Okay, so these are the diagnostic findings done in case of pulmonary embolism. Okay, so next coming to the management. Okay, so management, so mainly in first you have to do all the supportive therapy because there is no oxygenation. You have to increase the oxygenation by oxygen mask, or you can also start a ventilation with CPAP or a BiPAP or mechanical ventilator. Okay, so any of these according to the patient's ABG and saturation levels, you can give this procedure. Okay, and then you have to do all respiratory therapy like chest physiotherapy, coughing. Okay, physiotherapy, coughing, all those exercises should be done in order to remove the secretions from the throat. Okay, and next is mainly you have to give this patient anticoagulants. So there are so many drugs like low molecular weight heparin, okay, or any warfarin therapy according to the doctor's prescription, anticoagulants will be given. Okay, and heparin therapy also. So low molecular and also heparin therapy. And fibrinolytic therapy. So in order to remove the fibrin or clot material, they give fibrinolytic therapy with atelipase and relipase. Okay, so any of these paste can be given to reduce the clot. And then vasopressor agent. So in case of any congestive heart failure, when there is backflow of the blood and because of that venous stasis can occur, so you have to give vasopressor agents like pitricin to treat BP and also the pressure inside the blood vessels. Okay, so that will be given. And diuretics in case of again congestive heart failure to remove the excess fluid, they give the diuretics which is furosemide. Okay, so these are the drugs we can give in case of pulmonary embolism. Okay, another surgical management is one interventional therapy is there. It is also like surgery, that is IV filters. IVC means inferior vena cava filters. Okay, so this is surgically or through a femoral cut down. Okay, so vein. Okay, through femoral vein they insert a IVC filter. Okay, so IVC filter will be inserted so that this will be placed on the inferior vena cava. So when the blood is coming from the lower, so most of the time thrombosis is more prone in the lower part of the body, and it can from the lower extremities it can come up to the heart. Okay, so they put a filter in the inferior vena cava through the veins, and then when the clot is coming, this filter will filter the clot and send the blood inside the capillaries. Okay, IVC filters can be done, and pulmonary embolectomy. Okay, so that means through a angiography procedure they will crush the emboli. Okay, so that means they use a balloon or something to crush the emboli or the clot, and later they inject the anticoagulant so that further clot will not be formed. Okay, so any procedure, embolectomy or IVC filters is done. Okay, mainly in pulmonary embolism we have to do prevention. Okay, so prevention is the main strategy, because pulmonary embolism is a life threatening condition and it can also cause death if it is left untreated. Okay, so you have to, first one is you have to advise the person to wear anti-embolic stockings. So all patients who are prone for prolonged long standing and in immobility, they have to wear this anti-embolistic stockings. So okay, and then there is SCD devices, that is sequential compressive devices. Okay, so these devices, they are put on the leg, and it will be connected to an electronic supply, electric supply, and we have to maintain the pressure, and according to the pressure, it like a massage, it will pump the legs. Okay, so the device will be put on the leg, and it will massage the leg so that there will be there won't be stasis of the venous blood. Okay, and patients who are having clotting disorders, we have to tell them to take a more low molecular weight heparin injection, or a oral warfarin injection, oral warfarin tablets can be advised in order to prevent the clot. Okay, and in case of immobility and other thing, have to tell them to change position in the bed, position every 2 hourly, and okay, in case of obesity, you have to tell to cut down the weight. Okay, so weight reduction and dietary management should be taught in case of obesity. Okay, and post surgical patients, you have to monitor all the coagulation studies to see if the person is prone for getting the pulmonary embolism. Okay, so these are some of the prevention you have to do, and mainly at when patient is going home also with warfarin and low molecular weight heparin, we have to teach the side effects of those drug, that it can cause bleeding, and any bleeding the person has to report to the hospital. Okay, so these are the prevention strategies in pulmonary embolism. I hope you would have understood the class. Thank you for listening. If you like, please share and subscribe.